I'm Elizabeth, and this is Frans. I start with Frans. Frans is Dutch, was born in Holland, but then they moved to Zimbabwe, grew up in Zimbabwe, came back to Holland, studied first industrial design at the Design Academy in Eindhoven. Is it okay? Can you hear me back? Okay. And architecture at the AA in London. Worked for Alchimia, Milano, perhaps you know.
Ettore Slatsas or Mandini, famous in the 80s because they started postmodernism.
And then continued, worked for Rem Koolhaas, OMR, at the beginning of the OMR, worked on the Midlands Dance Theatre.
And the band Barcelona Pavilion.
That's the first project you find in SNLXL, a sort of hybrid space, exactly, at that time.
We both teach, we both have professorships in Germany, not in Berlin, but far away from Berlin. And the studio is based since 5 years in Berlin. After a period of theory, we now increasingly.
Frans is teaching at the Academy of Media Arts in Cologne. It's not an architectural but an art academy, and he's a professor for hybrid space. My name is Elizabeth Security. I grew up in Athens, studied in Paris and in Germany, Darmstadt. Architecture, then worked for quite a known German architect, Beinisch, big projects. One of his most known projects is the stadium in Munich, the Olympia Stadium in Munich. Taught in Berlin, then became a professor for architecture, design and landscape architecture school, and we've been working quite some time since 5 years we're based in Berlin. Hybrid Space Lab is our studio. As Frans started saying, we started with quite free, you would call them artistic, speculated projects, then went into theory because we had the feeling we had to explain what we're doing. We should create a language for what we were doing, and since quite some time, with having assignments, we're working very internationally.
20 years ago, 24 years ago when we started, the internet was not really there. It was it was an academic instrument that hadn't gone public. We had found out about it, and through our researches we were increasingly getting interested in networks. And this was, at that point also the internet became public, and we decided to work on the combination of the analog and the digital. And this is all pretty new. Computers had floppy disks, hardly any memory, and we had quite enormous difficulty in actually using machines. Which I think was quite a good thing, because we were forced to think about its concept, networks, etc., etc. And from that period, we used the name hybrid, the combination of fields, the analog and the digital, and we've moved on from that. Space, which is our area of expertise, and lab is because we work quite experimentally. We work theoretically, that's the first phase actually of our work, and increasingly combine that with what we of course always wanted to do, more practical work. Yeah?
We'll go a bit quicker because we've quite some material. One of the researches we did was about, together with Jan Xenakis, a musician, architect, one of the pioneers, we call him, of hybrid space, worked for Le Corbusier on the Ben Park Barcelona Pavilion, is one of the heroes of this sort of digital aesthetics of the digital times, but I won't go into it now. What we were really interested was not so much the formal aspect of this digitalization, but the idea of networks. Go to the next one. There's perhaps some of you have heard about the book of Castells, Space of Flows, Network Society. There's a space of places, what you can physically touch and the space of flows. And of course, a lot of economic warfare, etc., is in this space of flows. And we, from the beginning on, were interested in the interaction of space of flows and space of places.
Castel saw them as different places, the spaces of flows and the real spaces. We were arguing the opposite, actually, that there were two spaces that were coming together. At that point, you also had the digital city of Amsterdam. They were arguing we would only live digitally. And they were, as if we were rejecting the analog. We said, on the other hand, that the combination would be much more interesting. And I think that's been proven today. So the idea to fuse physical space and media space.
Hybrid space.
Hybrid space. We started this investigation, and then, let's say, 5-6 years later, we got our professorships, and that gave us the chance to go much and much deeper and really spend our time researching instead of trying to find jobs. Public Media Urban Interface was the first project done 23 years ago, and it's the start of a whole series of projects. Theoretical as well as practical models, etc. The idea was to replace the right to vote with the right to broadcast. And we tested this idea on London. We were studying at the AA at that time.
We were thinking about the city also as a physical but also as a political environment, then thinking about politics, and went into this idea of mediatization of politics and created a sort of space where we could imagine that coming. You want to describe it? Yeah. 1 to 7 million is 1 person to 7 million persons. That sort of scale. And we started also thinking, what are the notation of these communication spaces? How can we visualize them? What is a new language?
There was architectural notation, which we were learning, but there was, for this new field, there was nothing there. So we had to, one of the first things we did was, as for invent the instruments, the methods of drawing the space, of imagining it.
They were saying, oh, that's a utopian project, and we were answering, no, it's a utopia, it's about you. It's an open system, you can change, influence, create, participate.
Here you see a section through a building. At that time we weren't able to digitally produce these things, of course today we are. For us, a very important image, because I think it's 23 years ago.
We were thinking about bottom-up systems.
We started making models and testing these ideas on a small scale, sometimes also together with the Digital City in Amsterdam, with a famous conference called Doors of Perception, which was held in the, I think, in the beginning of the 90s in Amsterdam.
And there was a conference on recycle, and we did a communication with conference recycle project.
One of the first animations we made, again 23 years ago, we're zooming into London. Here you see the Thames running.
And you have a sort of division of London.
I can't stand that.
In neighbourhoods, very systematically. And the idea was that you get a sort of bottom-up network based on the locality. Not the internet protocol, but a bottom-up protocol. And you have a very simple rule that creates a very, very complex system. Replacing the right to vote with the right to broadcast, creating a bottom-up dynamic network, an open, narrow broadcasting catching system. These are texts of 23 years ago?
Yeah.
With explaining it, you have a local urban structure, so you have the neighborhoods here. Within the neighborhood, every citizen has some airtime for all broadcast and can go to the laundrette in the neighborhood, a very simple sort of interface, and create his message for the neighborhood. Can be a political message, can be his music group, can be him selling flowers. And it's broadcasted first within the neighborhood. But if you don't have your own message, you give your own airtime to another message, it goes up in the hierarchy, you just see it now, accelerates, and goes into a bigger sort of festivity hall, we call it Bridge Club, bridging the Thames and bridging between the locality and more global space. You see again the same sort of process happening. Notations and icons, the hammer and the Mickey Mouse, bringing them together. Walt Disney and the hammer.
Took us unbelievably long to render this kind of stuff. Image for image, nearly, and it took really years.
You see the process again. The little orange balls are the messages, the local messages that get accelerated and enter a more global space. So you get a bottom-up system.
And a hybrid system, an analog-digital system, yeah, that's important, a physical and non-physical.
And they go into the city. And then started, I mean, for us, networks were very important. The idea, the concept of network, and we had this sort of local network, bottom-up network based on the neighborhood, and then started thinking about mobile networks, buses driving around, etc., etc. You see, these are very, very imaginative projects, but you will see that the work we developed afterwards was very much based on this sort of, we call it meta world, this project. Yeah, a bit.
So we developed analog, in the beginning mainly analog models to kind of show how this network, what the qualities of this network was, how it looked, X-ray images as it were, models to try and also design this or find out what this new language would look like.
Also an aesthetic investigation connected to it.
The first publication came
90s.
Relatively late. We were already working 10 years on this idea.
And but on the cover of the Dutch architecture magazine. And what you see is the idea of notations, notations of processes, notations of communication processes. Not just plans, notations of physical space, but notation of all these processes, an architecture dealing with these processes. And we had to develop also notions, so we developed the notion of soft urbanism, dealing not only with the physical spaces, but also with the communication within urban environment. Yeah, that was...
First breakthrough came also in the beginning of the, I think of end of the 90s, where the Dutch government, having heard we were working on this new thing, and no one actually knew what the hell this internet was. It was only a few people had some experience, and they invited us to become part of a think tank. The Dutch government is relative. The Dutch are relatively modern, relatively quick in changing. At the moment, an enormous crisis is going on in Holland, and they will go from a social state to a participatory state. One of the first new things. And in this, let's say, in this mood of renewal, they invited us to think about what would be the future of space in context of the rise.
It was 99. Early, and it was a think tank that was interesting to see that was dealing with information communication, technology, and all sort of aspects that are relevant to society and governance, from security to international relations, health, and we had the theme of space, the use of space in the information communication age, and we added processing the unplannable, meaning it's about process.
Some of the topics we covered in this research.
The media, the hybrid, that was nearly one of the reasons we at the beginning lost the projects, because we were not talking about just the digital, but about the hybrid. And what we were very interested was not just information, but also communication. It wasn't just information, but it was also the media model. The themes, many things, transformation of the urban, from the global cities, suburbia, smart cities, dual city, the importance of location. At that time they were arguing, oh, location won't be important, and we were arguing, location is becoming even more important, at home or public space today.
Put quite some emphasis on the idea that we thought at that time we would all by now, or, well, we are, be carrying a mobile device.
At home on my portable PDA.
It goes further and further.
Then about planning, what would that would mean for planning, the next one? And then categories and instruments, and in that context we started thinking of new notions, and one of them was identity. Thinking of identity as a density of connections, and that on all levels. And it has many applications, identity of a person, identity of a person, but also as an instrument in urban development. It's a composite term consisting of the combination of the word density of communication space, density of connections, and the word identity. One of the themes we were very interested in was this sort of network paradigm, thinking of networks as a, it's a continuation, this sort of network science is a continuation of the research on complexity, chaos theories of the 80s, developed in network theory, looking like in a sort of X-ray view on the connections, on the processes, on the dynamic connections. And this sort of hybrid approach, with this sort of hybrid approach, we saw that we are that we were asked in many, many different fields, and one was them was the design. You want to explain?
Yeah, we were asked by the Dutch Institute, the Dutch Design Institute, spelling mistake here, which has been abolished. It's slightly unbelievable. The Dutch in the last years have abolished the Architectural Institute, the Institute for Electronic Arts, and the Design Institute, and putting them together now in something they call the New Institute. And we did part of the research for that institute. It's the attempt to get away from, let's say, the normal professional distinction and go into, move further. And because all these professions are mixing, there's no need to separate them anymore.
And you see that all these professions once have this common instruments, digital instruments, and also dealing with processes. Design is not anymore just about the chair, but it's about the whole process of fabrication. It's the process of communication with the customer. It's the participative elements in the co-creation, etc.
One of the most important things in this research for the Dutch Design Institute was trust. How do we generate trust through design?
Okay.
Yeah, here's some of the aspects of that. Things we thought were interesting. This is done quite some time ago. That's why the Fab Lab I would not put in anymore. Circuitry. Again, the emphasis on process-oriented.
Process-oriented has to do also with sustainability. Yeah? You don't look just at the object, but at the whole life cycle of the object, on its ecological backpack, etc.
And some years ago, the Art Academy where I work is called the Digital. It was meant to be the Digital Bauhaus. It was meant to, as it were, offer a new kind of industry to North Rhine-Westphalia, which is a predominantly steel and coal-dominated area. And the school has incredible funding. It's probably the only school in the world where the students actually get money to come. They don't pay anything. And we give them quite a lot of money to do projects. And the argumentation for the state giving this money to us is that we're at the forefront of innovation. A couple of years ago, we started doing 3D printing when it was not so popular. Took the whole thing to the Beijing Design Week and had quite some interesting workshops there. And as it were, introduced a couple of years ago 3D printing in Beijing. And that led to many other things. It's just for example, Forbes stating that we did the only interesting thing there. I don't completely believe him. He wasn't there, so, but still.
Of course, the projects we do are sometimes client-oriented. That is, the client comes to us and comes with a certain question. In this case, an exhibition on architecture and urbanity in 2006 in an old coal factory, and they asked us to do something with the 40 interviews they had with urbanists and architects. And 40 interviews with architects and urbanists at an exhibition is a difficult topic. Normally you would put headphones on, listen to the interviews. We decided to do something completely different. First of all, we didn't have, there were going to be 300,000 visitors, so the idea of having everyone put headphones on and off and on and off was not a good idea. So we developed a system for these to, as it were, communicate these interviews. We were very happy with the whole result, but decided later on to go one step further. And we were exhibiting this at quite a lot of museums. And we, through waiting and tinkering with the system, we found that we actually made an instrument. And the instrument, you see here some of the components, the speaker, which acts also as a microphone, two very thin copper or very thin copper foil that we could put on any type of surface. We specially developed this. Germany is the area we are. We have relatively good contacts to all the big companies, and they're very willing to help us develop new materials. And what we developed was an instrument. You see here a bit the work on the instrument. From the instrument. The software, we build our own instruments, our own hardware, our own software. The ratio of students is about, I think, 6 to 1, 6 students to 1 professor, which gives us a very strong contact. Specialized sound department. Anthony Moore, producer of Pink Floyd, runs it. It's the instrument, the computers, of course, we buy, but we modify them.
Volgende dan.
Volgende.
Ja,
sorry. Ja,
doe maar. Oké.
2004,
yes. We skipped some projects. We're going now into more urban projects. We were asked by the initiative that was setting up the European Capital of Culture 2010 in the Ruhr region in Germany, to develop some concepts for them, to develop some ideas, what sort of project they could run. And we developed a whole series for them. One of them was had as a target group the, you would call it, immigrant housewife sitting at home and not knowing what her connection to the cultural capital could be. And we thought, well, hospitality. So we developed the idea of urban diners. The ones of you who understand German, at that moment, the motto of the cultural capital application was Essen für das Ruhrgebiet, and we just added via Essen für das Ruhrgebiet.
Essen means eating.
Essen means eating, and Essen is a city. It's a big city in Germany. Essen for the Ruhr region, eating for the Ruhr region. We are eating for the Ruhr region. That was a play of words. And we developed a concept or a project proposal that the years before the cultural capital, you would have in the neighborhoods decentralized diners. So you would have the local networks being set up. And the last year, the year of the cultural capital, at one night, you would block the highway. It's an agglomeration, so the highway is a very important sort of network for the whole region. And you would have a huge dinner on the highway. Well, the cultural capital did not do the first phase, but did the second phase. So one day they blocked 40 kilometers of highway and had 3 million of inhabitants, participants to this event. What was for us again important is the idea of networks, the networks of local networks and communication networks. The next project was first developed for the Hong Kong social housing authorities. They were asking us to develop a project about young people that do not play outside. They sit behind their computer screens, but they do not play outside. And we developed the idea of CityKid, an idea of flexible structures that can be put in several spaces from time to time, and a concept of a combination of computer games and urban games.
Then you continue. Just looking to a point where we have in some way too much material. The idea was to have combined a game whereby you would have elements. The elements would fit together like a Lego game. And these elements were mirrored in reality by, let's say, the same elements, but then real elements made of wood or whatever. The kids would, from, let's say, a kind of Lego box, assemble either a mini theater, a playground, or whatever. The thing would be sent off to the, let's say, the distributor. A car would come, a small pickup, would place the elements there. The kids would kind of go to the playground, put the elements together, and in that way form a kind of temporary, either a small theater, a playing ground, or whatever. The thing would be packed again after 2 days, would be taken back to the assembly spot, and a new kind of cycle would start. They found the idea very interesting, but we never got to actually executing it, but they asked us as a kind of compensation to do then to prove that we could do this. We built one small, very cheap pavilion for the Hong Kong Shenzhen Biennial 2009.
A do-it-yourself pavilion. It's a very simple system. You show the plan, the next slide, yeah? It's elements plywood bound together with cable binders, with a quite a sophisticated lettering system so you can put the puzzle together, and it traveled at several locations in Hong Kong and Shenzhen. And what we found very interesting, it's a system you can rearrange. Eh? It's quite a flexible structure. It's a cheap structure, it's a flexible structure. Inside you see a bit, that's the model, a bit the situation. You have projections in this sort of crystalline interior with that cable binders also playing with the light. You can go quicker.
A design for a theater in the north of Holland. We'll just show some images. The idea was to break the theater up in kind of tiny parts and distribute those tiny parts around the city. And then on, let's say, on a certain Sunday, the material would all come back, the stuff would come back, and it would be placed in the central square. I'm not explaining it very well. So slowly from theory, we're moving into more urban and architectural
projects. What we were asked is to develop typologies for staging media arts. What is media arts, and especially in a more performing media arts. And we developed some ideas and building for that. Continue. And then we experienced that this idea of mixing digital and analog is also a strategy. And we started seeing it as a working strategy, mixing fields. And one of the themes is nature texture, looking at the combinations of technology and nature.
Very strong magnets with a kind of, how do you say that, feeding?
Matter, yeah. Mat.
Kind of material in which we've put seeds. You can throw them at metal structures, they will stick there, and then will start growing. So. But they're still there. A pavilion we designed for the, but not built, for the kind of unnatural reserve. Somewhere in the middle of Holland, between two cities, you have an area that was designated in the 80s as an industrial zone. Komt het ver? So one of the key images is this one, a test by Russians to actually, as it were, have a dog's head and then a mechanical pump. It worked, apparently.
Yeah. It's a sort of nature reserved on man-made land. Holland is an artificial country. So it was a polder, meaning land that was gained from the sea, that was designated actually for industrial development. Then the economic crisis of the 80s came, nothing was built, birds came, in bushes started growing, then the environmentalists discovered it and decided to bring big grazing animals in, so they start having a more ecological balance. The next picture.
They're not, the idea is that people are not allowed to go into this area, only the scientists. And here you have the two cities. So the problem that this area had, the people who were actually taking care of the area, was how to communicate the fact that you couldn't go in, but still the municipality had to pay for this area. And the idea was to have a small pavilion at the edge.
Next one. Yeah. The idea was to have a sort of communication pavilion at the edge of the nature reserve, so people, visitors, could go there and understand something about it, but not very limiting the entry into the area. Next one.
So one of the ideas was to develop, as it were, research, new research instruments for the scientists. At the same time, we wanted the normal public to also have some kind of influence in this exhibition.
Go so back. We would back. Yeah. So you would have an exhibition space with sound, visuals, etc., etc. And the concept was that you have a sort of database, not only by the scientists, but also by the laymen, bird watchers, etc. So the curator's role was just to work with the material was delivered, a sort of participatory exhibition. The next was that was 2010, research on electromobility and the cityscape. We were asked, is electromobility a technical theme? Does it have anything to do with the city, with the quality of urban environment?
The movie is for a very broad public and tries to explain not only the advances of, or the advantages of electromobility, but its effects on the city. And the last thing is hardly understood by a larger public. And from, let's say, the limitations of our computer power in the beginning, we've kind of developed styles that for which we hardly need, as it were, strong computers anymore.
And what is for us very important is to communicate processes. This research was done for a combination of institutes dealing with electromobility and behavior, and a museum on architecture and engineering combined. And they asked us, yeah, what is it about in the cityscape? This has been quite influential in Germany. Cities have started thinking about these themes, meaning how to appropriate spaces, mobility spaces, into greener spaces, rethinking these possibilities.
Of course, the connection to mobile technology, owning a car, is not any more important, but I think access to mobility is much more important. Especially in Germany, whereby it's more or less traditional that becoming 18 you would get a car. This has nearly stopped.
Yeah, young people don't even go for their driving license.
So that's for Germany an incredible change. We do these animations, I think they take us two weeks or something. Relatively quick for the need for animation comes from that the drawings are simply not any more enough to explain anything.
And again, it's about process. If you think about urbanism or architecture today, it's not any more thinking about aesthetic than about the processes. You can skip now. One of the recent projects is a project we're now developing. We're having the first workshop in May in Berlin. It's about bringing creative professions and designers with people from health.
The idea is that design thinking could solve all kinds of social problems. Is anyone familiar with the idea of social design?
Yes.
Okay, and the Dutch are very much busy with this, as they think it could solve many of the social problems, let's say, in all kinds of communities. The idea is to not focus on the medical parts, on the medical side of health, but to focus on happy health, to think
and
of
lifestyle and environment. And again, I mean, what you see is a bit the sort of working, mixing different fields, not being classical architects, urbanist designers, but always looking at the interfaces of the different fields.
At the moment, we're working for the Ministry of Foreign Affairs working on a large exhibition, the Hannover Messe, and a part of the Hannover Messe is dedicated to metropolitan solutions.
Hannover Messe is the big Hannover exhibition. It's about industrial innovation, and part of it, this metropolitan solutions, is not about, you know, selling, I don't know, a sort of sensor or solar panel, but about people from cities exhibiting their integrated solutions for cities. And they asked us to curate a part, the Dutch part of it, because Holland is the partner country this year. And again, it's about integration of all these technological developments within the city.
At the moment, we're working on an area in Beijing, 798, the art district. We were asked recently, together with a group of Chinese architects and media artists, Interactive Beijing, to work the 798 area, is Beijing's famous art area. It's more or less it's lost its character, you would say.
It's an old factory.
And here you see a bit the situation with, let me think, the factories not working anymore, housing being developed on the edges, old gas storage tanks being transferred into museums. But apparently this is not enough, and we're, let me see what kind of images I have.
And they want to, it can be, and they want to, in some way, to do a sort of pilot project there to address the themes we see here. It's about political, economical. It also has a lot to do with sustainability, social sustainability, and ecological sustainability.
Last year we were quite surprised. We got an invitation to come to a conference and discuss the quality of air. And of course, in Berlin, that's no problem. Berlin is probably one of the cleanest cities, and so we were wondering why the hell. Of course, it was very clear. The pollution in Beijing is so enormous that an enormous action, an enormous response has started. And that's, I think, super, super interesting.
And it's about, not only about physical, but about lifestyle change. Yeah? And this space will be a synergy of creative production, exhibition, but also commercial spaces, education, etc. All around creativity and arts. And they call it the hybrid experience plan.
The idea of mixing the analog and the digital.
And not only, they're not looking just for a master plan, but also about the process. How are we going to develop it? And how are we going to influence the lifestyle of people? And that's a small example of the work that will be in there. For example, it's a sort of green card where you have a sort of sustainability credits added or deducted from it. So you get incentives for a more sustainable lifestyle. Will you move it to the
Yeah.
Yeah. You wish that?
No.
Okay. Well, thank you very much.
We
were asked in Hong Kong, it was a curator working together with the social housing authorities to develop a concept. And this concept was about having elements, modular elements that can be put together. At the end, the project was not realized, but we realized the do-it-yourself pavilion, the pavilion that was within the architecture biennial, the city biennial, Hong Kong and Shenzhen.
But storage, no, we never got there.
I have a proposal about like a mobile library, and my tutor asked me to build a storage for that, all the facilities and the structures, material. So whether we need a storage for the projects like that.
But in this case, we had imagined having, let's say, several depots around Hong Kong whereby you would have the elements. Yeah, sure. But of course, you can think of other ways.
You can think of containers, you can think of trucks, you can think of many mobile storage also possibilities.
Yeah,
thanks for the presentation, Molly. I was quite interested in your idea of soft urbanism, and I was thinking with the kind of this introduction to the digital age and telecommunications, we're kind of experiencing kind of a shortening of time, kind of our experience of instantaneous messaging, kind of sharing of information. And I was wondering whether your idea of soft urbanism has kind of was influenced by that, or you could maybe expand on maybe the idea of soft urbanism.
Leg het gewoon uit.
I'm not sure whether there was
any. You need to make contact with our soft urban.
Soft urbanism was thinking of the communication processes within the city, yeah?
Yeah.
And you see, I mean, we developed it quite some time ago, we started developing it quite some time ago, and from this idea we were very much interested in participative projects. And we're thinking also the models where you saw were models of participation, yeah? Because I don't think that the expert role is disappearing, yeah? You still need an expert, but he is a different expert anymore. Of course you have, what you're talking about is about a change in time, huh? The acceleration of time. What does that mean for urban structures?
Yeah.
One thing that of course it means for urban structures, we're much more open to temporary structures. Yeah? And, but that does not mean that the stable the quality of stable structures disappears, even the upgraded in the quality. You see, both tendencies in architecture, on one hand fluctuating temporary structures, on the other hand a sort of, you could call it nostalgia of need, for something that is very stable and very non-communicative. I don't know if I'm in any way going into your question.
Yeah, no, I don't know, I guess I was interested in your soft urbanism. Is that you say it's principally to do with networking and communications.
Yeah.
I was wondering whether that has a link with the age of telecommunications and
Of course.
I mean, we've used the word to, as it were, oppose the normal attitude in urbanism, whereby you would not think of that.
And when we started with, nobody understood why its relevance, huh?
Yeah.
Urbanism was only about, you know, making a sort of master plan and defining the shapes, but not about thinking of the processes to build there. And I think that has, in the meantime, quite changed.
Yeah, also because public participation has increased. The Germans are very worried because sometimes, I think last year in Stuttgart, a new modern building was, as it were, blocked in favor of a fascist building, and simply to keep some trees in the park. And this led to a kind of fear under the German authorities of, let's say, the rise of, you would say, of democracy in Germany, because all of a sudden people would start influencing the debate, let's say, about a building or whatever.
And I think that is something, especially your generation, will have to deal with. Huh? You see it on many, many, many fields. You see it in, perhaps you know the notion of consumer. It's prosumer, the consumer that is also producing. You have the fab lab sort of developments, and you have this participatory project. So you see a sort of exteriorization of planning and a sort of questioning also of the expert's role. I don't think that the expert will disappear, because many, many problems, you cannot deal with them with a very shallow sort of knowledge about them. But the way the expert will be working will change, for sure, is changing already.
What were your thoughts exactly on analog and digital? Did you think that analog and digital are going to merge, or the space that they behave in?
Both.
But don't you think that today also there's a sort of polarization of it as well, that because everything's becoming really digitalized, that I think in terms of politics as well, that there is a need for concrete, everything's becoming so individual and digital, that everything's just, there's a huge divide as well, there's a huge connection. Is that?
It's always both. Yeah. I think if you have a development, you always have the counter need. That's clear. That's always like that. But you have a development, and you see it in everything. You see it in the way people use parks, for example. Huh?
Yes.
You see it the way people use public space. Huh? And that has influences in the way you design public space. You design parks.
Mm.
Earlier on, I would say you had a much bigger need for intimacy in a space. You had in restaurants, you had small departments, compartments. In parks, you had smaller niches. And today, you see that people just sit somewhere in the middle of nothing, and they feel at home. They're all communicating with somebody somewhere else in the middle of nothing, and they have the idea of personal space and intimacy, and privacy has changed and it's influencing. So we don't think what we are interested is in this interplay on all levels. The way offices change, the way home changes, and what does that have impact in designing cities, for example. Huh?
I'm really interested in that. Are you trying to say that maybe the private has gone into this other space then, you know, we've retreated into more of a digital space?
Well, your cyberspace is not so private.
Yeah, I was going to say,
No, we think that you have an inversion of privacy. The concept of privacy could be a very historical concept, meaning defined by, privacy is an historical concept. I think it was even developed in England when you have this sort of you didn't have this enfilade. You know, enfilade is the classical layout when you have one access and from one room you get to the next room. Mm. Yeah, that wasn't private because you have to pass your roommates, housemates, sort of space to go into your bed. It developed when you have the corridor. So privacy is this private chamber. It's also a sort of mental concept. So it's historical. What we're experiencing today is a change. I can't tell you exactly what it is. We're looking for it. We're discussing it, interrogating, but there is a change. This concept of being private is not there for any sort of, to have anything for easiness. You give all your personal data out, and you know you give them out. But you're doing it.
Yeah, that's a good question.
Anybody else? Okay, cool. Thank you so much for the lecture. Thank you, everyone, for coming. Thank you.